Well, hello everybody. My name is Jason DeCosta. Welcome to my show. Thank you for joining me today. Today we're going to be talking about some exciting stuff that I think is kind of mishandled and misread by many in the full preterist community. Mainly today we're going to be talking about those gates that will never shut in the 21st chapter of Revelation. After all this fun stuff is done, all the events have taken place, the promises are inherited, and we see this picture of these gates that will never shut. So what's going on in the confusing book of Revelation? We're going to try to explain that today in its proper context, and we'll do that in just a moment. I've mentioned this before, and I think it's worth taking another note of. When we, as full preterists, when we take things at face value in terms of the time statements, we do ourselves a lot of good. When we were futurists in our thinking, we looked at these time statements and the words of Jesus and the apostles and the disciples, and we sort of tried to either, read over them without paying them much attention and just kind of act like they weren't there, or we kind of tried to do like a spiritual kind of twist to them where, you know, a generation doesn't exactly mean a generation, or, you know, whatever we had to do to get around them, you know, we usually did it. And most of us did it without even realizing it. And I know I did. If I would have known these things right from the get-go, I would have never been a futurist. But about, you know, 7 years ago when I first started to study the Bible, I, you know, had about a year where I was heavy into futurism because, number one, that's sort of where you go when you become a Christian. It's basically all that's around you, you know, so you just kind of jump in. But then when you sort of get your feet under yourself and you get grounded a little bit, then you start to realize that nothing that they say is actually in there, in the Bible. And so you kind of come out of it. But I think when we come into Christianity as, you know, whether we were atheists before or whatever we were, and we, you know, come into this view, this faith, we actually come into it with sort of a set way of understanding it. We come into it with, okay, we're going to come to the Bible and we're going to understand that it's completely spiritual. And this is the way it's done. So we sort of mold to that. We mold to our environment and our surroundings and what people who have been in the view longer than us tell us. But really, when there's mass confusion and mass chaos in the view and no agreement and disagreement and discord and turmoil like there is in the 43,000 views of Christianity today, then you kind of need to just take a step back and sort of do your own thing. And I don't mean, you know, go rogue on everybody, but just, you know, look at the Bible through a calm, cool, collected, normal view, and see what it actually says. And that's worked very well for me. So when I say take things at face value, I mean like we did with the time statements. You know, we looked at Jesus saying, some of you standing here will not taste death till the Son of Man comes in his kingdom. And we took that for what it means. We said, hey, there were people standing in front of Jesus when he said this. He was speaking to them, not us. And he told them that some of them would not die before he came for them. So clearly he meant it, okay? And I think we need to consider doing that in other aspects of the story as well. I think we, you know, the full preterists mainly, they, you know, they do this well in terms of the time statements and in terms of, you know, the words that like you and we and everything, they kind of look at that and say, well, this was probably speaking more about them. But they sort of go off of that method of interpretation when it's not convenient. In other words, they want to keep themselves in the game, so they'll look at some pronouns as, you know, them and others as us, and, you know, and different things like that. So there's a lot wrong with that, but I think if we took things at face value, such as Israel being actually Israel, okay, rather than some spiritual concept whereby today you have these people who are being somewhat born spiritually by the gospel, being, you know, like these Christians, these full preterist believers believe that the first century church was the bride, okay? God took his bride, and then somehow, whoever was a bride there, most of them think that these people stayed on the earth, and they don't believe, you know, some other statements, but whoever was a bride there when that light switch inside of them happened. It's just funny to even think. When that light switch inside of them happened, you had this completed bride. All right, so now you have this full number of the bride, all right? And then that bride, it automatically starts producing babies, all right? And then the babies produce babies, and the babies produce babies, and the babies produce babies. And you just have babies, a lot of babies, okay? So that's their view. It's very, very silly when it's held up against the scriptures. There's absolutely nothing that proves it, and I'll probably do a teaching on that soon. But the bride was the same thing as the sons of God. When Paul in Romans 8 told them that, the creation was waiting and longing for the revelation of the sons of God, that's what the bride was. It was the creation. It was going to be the sons of God being revealed from and being redeemed from that corruption. And those sons of God were the children of Israel, and they were also called the bride of Christ and so on. So there's different ways of saying things, but there's absolutely nothing in the text that suggests that anybody is a spiritual baby today, okay? And I love the fact that guys like Mike Miano will now deny that they believe we are spiritual Israel today because they realize that all Israel was already saved. So they've modified it to sort of wiggle around that chokehold. And now they say, no, we're the babies. We're not spiritual Israel, we're the babies. And so, but what he's not realizing is if the first century church was Israel, okay, and Israel, I guess, mated with God, I don't even know how he would explain this, but if Israel and Christ were married and they had spiritual babies, that would make you spiritual Israel, wouldn't it? Because that's Israel, you know, the marriage took place between Israelites. So, and then he claims that he's not spiritual Israel and he's something else. So it's just a big mess. And I think this Israel only push that's going on lately has really brought light to the chaos. But yeah, so take things at face value. Israel is Israel. There's nothing spiritual about it. If you know the story and you know it from the Old Testament and you follow it through the generations of Israel and their history here in the Bible, you know that when we come to the New Testament, what's going on there is simply the reverse of the curse that Moses warned them about. If they didn't obey God's law, it would be a curse to them. And that's the curse. That's all it is. You know, these Israelites were scattered out in the nations. They had abandoned Yahweh's law. They were dead in the uncircumcision of their flesh. They were guilty for, you know, not obeying the laws of handwritten ordinances. And the gospel goes out to them to tell them that, you know, believe in your Redeemer and he will forgive you and save you from those sins, those transgressions of the law. And that's really all it is. And we see that very clearly. But you know, take that at face value. Take the caught up, the changed in the twinkling of an eye, where we will forever be with the Lord, waiting for the upward call. They will marvel at him. We will be like him in that day. Try taking those statements at face value and see what kind of result you get. To me, it works very nicely. You have the end of the age and you have a bunch of literally probably 50 different statements that suggest there was something amazing that was going to take place for them in the twinkling of an eye. Paul said that flesh and blood could not inherit the kingdom of God. Therefore, they would need to be changed in the twinkling of an eye to inherit that kingdom of God. All right. Now, whatever you want that to mean is your opinion, is your choice. But to me, having come full circle in it now, I can see that, you know, pardon my language here, but the sun shines on a dog's ass every once in a while. And what I mean by that is, even the futurist gets some things right. The futurist looks for a literal rapture, of course. They're way off in time and they have no clue what they're talking about there, but they do get the literal, you know, the literal stuff about the rapture right. And I've come full circle to see that, yes, there was actually a taking away. There was actually a change in the twinkling of an eye where they would be caught up. And if you haven't read any of Ed Stevens' work on that, you should, because it's pretty good. And that's not what convinced me. I don't take anybody's word for anything. In fact, I read very few books. I've probably read less than 10 books from full preterist authors in my 5 years as a preterist, probably less than five in full. I read tidbits of things, but I don't like reading a lot of things because I like arriving at my own conclusions in a clean and unforced way. In other words, I don't want somebody's opinion to sort of push me in a direction that I don't want to go. I want to get there naturally and unforced, and I want to see it because I'm extremely critical with myself and I'm extremely honest with myself. And I don't, I won't believe something just to make myself comfortable. I'll take the hard way, and I've maintained that position. And I'll go where truth leads. But yeah, so take things at face value, see what it does. For me, it's actually made a lot of sense of the story, and I'm more confident now than I've ever been in the details. But enough about all that. Today we're going to be talking about gates, okay? When we look at the end of the book of Revelation, Revelation chapter 21, we read a portion that kind of throws people off. I'll read it for you just so we can get started. So Revelation chapter 21, verse 22 and forward says this, speaking of the glory of the New Jerusalem. But I saw no temple in it, for the Lord God Almighty and the Lamb are its temple, and the city had no need of the sun or of the moon to shine in it, for the glory of God illuminated it. The Lamb is its light. And the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light, and the kings of the earth bring their glory and honor into it. Ready? Its gates shall not be shut at all by day, there shall be no night there. And they shall bring the glory and honor of the nations into it, but there shall by no means enter in anything that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie, but only those who are written in the Lamb's book of life. All right, so first things first here. Before we go getting all caught up and carried away in all the details and everything of this thing and looking at words like nations, which is a poor translation, and saying, hey, look, it's talking about ongoing nations always coming in because these gates are never going to be shut, okay? What you can sometimes do in the Bible is you can go to portions in the, you can go to little sentences in a confusing portion, and you can find a sort of a grand slam statement in that sentence which limits how far you can push your imagination of what's going on in this extreme symbolism. All right, and what I mean by that is the very last sentence of that portion there, which says, "There shall by no means enter anything in it that defiles or causes an abomination or a lie." Here's the key, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. Well, obviously we know when the Lamb's Book of Life was opened, do we not? The Lamb's Book of Life is tied and linked to and central to Israel's last days. All right, if you look at Daniel's prophecy in Israel's last days, when the resurrection and judgment was taking place, the books would be opened and those written in the book would inherit eternal life. When we look at Revelation and the last things that take place in chapter 20 at the great throne judgment, we see that Israel's raised and their books are opened, and all those who are written in the book of life inherit their promise. All right, so we know that the book of life comes from Israel's history in Exodus, Malachi, and so on. So the book of life is exclusive to Israel. It pertained to nobody else. All right, pertained to nobody else. So we know that only those who were written in the Lamb's book of life would enter the city. And we know that the book of life was opened at the end of Israel's days. So therefore, nobody is entering the city afterwards because there is no sequel to the book of life. There is no book of life part 2, 3, 4. You know, Lord of the Rings type deal here. The book of life was opened, so this is a completed picture. All right, but we're going to prove that. So, when we look at this and we look at the beginning of this, and it says, verse 24, and the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light. The word there for nations is just ethnos, and it's so misunderstood in the New Testament. It's really, that's really where most of this confusion comes from, is the translations of the word nations and Gentiles and things like that. It just really balls people all up. Really, all it means is a multitude, all right, or associated or living together, a company, a troop, a swarm, a multitude of individuals of the same nature, a tribe, a people group, whatever the case may be. Sure, there are times where nations are used to represent nation groups outside of the people of Israel, you know, and so on and so forth. But the context here is simply a multitude of individuals, a tribe, a people group, individuals associated with each other. So just picture the individuals or this multitude of individuals that are saved shall enter into this city's light. That's really all it's saying. It's just the way that it's translated. It's very poor. And then it says, and the kings of the earth shall bring their glory and honor into it. And we know that, you know, places in the Old Testament, it's just pulling from Israel's history, like such as Jeremiah 17:19, which says, thus the Lord said to me, go and stand in the public gate through which the kings of Judah come in and go out, as well as in all the gates of Jerusalem. It's just pulling off of more Israel's history, and it's really just all about that. The kings, and actually Paul calls the saints the kings, and in Revelation, I think it's 3, we hear the kings that are coming in. So it was really just another word for this royal priesthood that was being saved in those last days. Holy nation and so on. So, but here's the part that really throws people off. It says, its gates shall not be shut at all by day. There shall be no night there. So when they look at that, these ones who want to push this into our day, they say, look, the gates shall not be shut at all by day. And that's, you know, that means that everybody can come in because the gates are not going to be shut. That means there's no closing. It's always open for all time. Anybody of all time can come in. And they ignore the fact that only those written in the Lamb's Book of Life, which is said 2 sentences later, limits this and doesn't allow that. But they press forward into this thinking about these gates being open for all time. Well, let's try to understand what's actually going on here. All right, so gates are mentioned often in Scripture. All right, and gatekeepers were an important part of maintaining order in ancient societies. They were gatekeepers guarding, you know, these gates, and they were stationed basically for protection, which would be at city gates, palace gates, temple gates. In these cities, they had these high, thick walls around them to keep out invading armies, mostly enemies, wild beasts, and so on. So heavy gates were set within those walls, and they allowed entrance and exit into the city. And so a gatekeeper had to be, you know, a trustworthy and alert person, and they had to be, you know, alert for any signs of trouble. He couldn't be, you know, lazy. If a gatekeeper messed up, he could bring ruin to the whole civilization. So the idea of a gatekeeper implies alertness and security, all right, and protection. Keep that in mind. All right. Now in 1 Chronicles 9, we see David and Samuel appoint 212 gatekeepers for positions of trust in guarding the temple of the Lord. They would, these gatekeepers would spend the night, okay, key here, they'd spend the night stationed around the house of God because they had to guard it, and they had charge of the key for opening it each morning. So picture that at night the gates are shut, and in the morning these gatekeepers would open it, and we'll read that right now just so you can see. So 1 Chronicles 9, verses 22 to 27 say this: all those chosen as gatekeepers were 212. They were recorded by their genealogy in their villages. David and Samuel the seer had appointed them to their trusted office. So they and their children were in charge of the gates of the house of the Lord, the house of the tabernacle, by assignment. The gatekeepers were assigned to the four directions, the east, the west, the north, and the south. And their brethren in their villages had to come with them from time to time for 7 days. For in this trusted office were 4 chief gatekeepers. They were Levites, and they had charge over the chambers and treasuries of the house of God. And they lodged all around the house of God because they had the responsibility, and they were in charge of opening it every morning. All right, so we can see a little bit more of that right there. But basically, in a nutshell, these gatekeepers would be in charge of locking at night and opening in the morning. And really, the reason is because at nighttime, it's a lot harder to protect. You can't see things as much. It's much easier for an enemy to attack when, you know, you can't see them. So at nighttime, the gates were shut. All right. Let me see what else I noted here. Ezra records that 139 gatekeepers made the trip from Babylon to Jerusalem with Zerubbabel. And when Nehemiah had finished the rebuilding of the wall around the city of Jerusalem, gatekeepers were some of the first positions he appointed. And this is significant because before a city could actually conduct business, it needs to be protected from outside invaders. So the city of Jerusalem required gatekeepers for the same reason. All right. So that's pretty much all I want to say about the gates there. But what I really want you to notice is that gates were a very important part of ancient societies, especially Jerusalem. In the pre-exilic city, the wall had many gates. And then when the wall was rebuilt, when they came back to Jerusalem, the wall had even more gates. And you can kind of read about them in different areas of Scripture in the Old Testament. But gates are everywhere and gatekeepers are everywhere. And you can see that the gates were always kind of referred to as when Jerusalem would be treated harshly, you know, they would, the prophets would say that enemies came through their gates and so on and so forth. And so keep all that in mind. And we're going to read just a few places in the Old Testament. We'll start at Obadiah 1. Obadiah was the lazy prophet. He just wrote one chapter and then he went to the bar. He gave up pretty quickly. But in Obadiah 1, verse 10, we read this. It's about Edom mistreating his brother Jacob. It says, "For violence against your brother Jacob, shame shall cover you, and you shall be cut off forever. In the day that you stood on the other side, in the day that strangers carried captive his forces," ready? "When foreigners entered his gates and cast lots for Jerusalem, even you were as one of them. But you should have not gazed on the day of your brother in the day of his captivity, nor should you have rejoiced over the children of Judah in the day of their destruction, nor should you have spoken proudly in the day of distress. You should have not entered the gate of my people in the day of their calamity. Indeed, you should have not gazed on their affliction in the day of their calamity, nor laid hands on their substance," blah, blah, blah. All right, so you can see here that the prophet is condemning Edom for entering into the gates and afflicting and taking part in the affliction of his brother Jacob. So we can see the gates were, again, symbolic of protection, and they transgressed those gates and trespassed those gates, and they entered into the city. All right, and then when we go over to the prophet Nehemiah, we see more of this in chapter 7, verse 1 to 3, we read this. "Then it was, when the wall was built, that I had hung the doors, when the gatekeepers, the singers, and the Levites had been appointed, that I gave the charge of Jerusalem to my brother Hanani and Hananiah, the leader of the citadel, for he was a faithful man and feared God more than many. And so I said to them, 'Do not let the gates of Jerusalem be opened until the sun is hot. And while they stand guard, let them shut and bar the doors and appoint guards from among the inhabitants of Jerusalem, one at his watch station and another in front of his own house.'" So again, we can see that the gates of Jerusalem were not to be opened until the sun was hot, playing again on the gates being shut at night. Okay. And then if we go over to Nehemiah chapter 13, verses 19, hold on one second. 13 verse 19 says this. "So it was at the gates of Jerusalem, as it began to be dark before the Sabbath, that I commanded the gates to be shut and charged that they must not be opened until after the Sabbath." So again, you can see that as it began to be dark, the gates were shut. All right, so now let's go back to Revelation and just read that portion again. Said, "And the nations of those who are saved shall walk in its light, and the kings of the earth bring their glory and honor into it. Its gates shall not be shut at all by day. There shall be no night there." Okay, so what's important to notice there? What's important to notice is that there will be no night there. And that's the reason why the gates would not be shut at all. Okay, and it all plays into protection again, what we talked about in the beginning. Okay, the reason why the gates were shut at night was for protection purposes. Okay, Jerusalem was always under siege. They had enemies all around them. The enemies encompassed them. They would often try to breach them. And so the gates would be shut and they would have to be watched. And gatekeepers were a huge part of society. All right, so its gates shall not be shut at all by day. And the most important part of this is the parentheses, "there shall be no night there," is simply saying protection. All right, they will need no more protection because they will be in the city of their God where there'll be no night. The God would illuminate it. They wouldn't have any threat or any fear. He would wipe their tears from their eyes. They would live forever. They would glory and worship their Redeemer, age unending. And the gates of that city would not be shut. All it means is symbolically is that there would be no threat of an enemy. There would be no threat of disaster and destruction. They would be safe. That's really all it means, folks. I just wanted to, you know, bring that to your attention because I feel like people botch that one and they look at that. And that's one of the main texts that people use to prove that the kingdom is ongoing and people can enter in. When really, we know that this portion limits how far we can push this, because it says only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life could enter that city. All right, and then we see that its gates shall not be shut at all by day. There shall be no night there, just simply meaning they will be protected and there would be no threat of an enemy. And I just gave you a handful of Old Testament passages on gates there. If you really wanted to, you could do a search and find numerous portions about gates and about how the gates and the gatekeepers were the protection for the city, and they would, you know, warn if there was enemies approaching and whatnot. So that's really all it's about. And yeah, so that's pretty much, I believe that's all I wanted to cover today. Yeah, we'll leave it at that for now, and we'll let you guys get moving, and we'll be back another time for another teaching. Thanks for joining me, guys, and have a great day. Bye-bye.